I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.
You are on to Energy Matters right here on NCBN. I am Eunice Johnson, and as always, we bring you all things energy, ranging from the power, oil, and gas sector. Now, today is no different on the episode, as we'll bring you issues relating to metering and its gap, bridging the gap precisely in Nigeria. Now, signs that a huge metering gap still exists despite the recent launch of the mass metering program of electricity, and it is quite bothersome considering its disturbing impact on consumers. The status quo clearly signals the prevalent character of metering problem, tied to what some might term the lack of enthusiasm of electricity distribution companies, popularly known as DISCOs, to address the problem. Up until now, the measures by government to tackle the problem has had very little impact due to failure of DISCOs to complement them, and many say it is becoming clear that except the government adopts stringent measures, the average Nigerian will continue to bear the brunt of electricity billings. Today on Energy Matters, we will be paying attention to metering issues in Nigeria, as well as the review of the unit price of end-use meters under the Meter Assets Provider Mass Metering Regulations. And my guest is on standby to do justice to that right after the break. Do stay tuned.
I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.
So there was a point where many Nigerians had to grapple with the issue of estimated billing. But along the line came the metering system, where you pay as you use electricity. But of course, that did not stop, as it also had its own challenges. And Nigerians have also had to complain at one point or the other regarding some of the challenges faced, while also relishing the use of meters as compared to estimated billing. Before we went on a break, I told you we have a guest. And today we will be analyzing the issues bordering on bridging the metering gap in Nigeria. My guest is Olabode Showumi. He is an energy analyst, and also he has a whole lot to do with the gas to power supply, and you get to find out more about him in the course of this interview, but let's just go on straight to it. You're very much welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, so metering is supposed to be one that would make a whole lot of people breathe a sigh of relief from the fire that they faced, if I may put it that way, with regards to estimated billing. But along the line came the issue of to pay or not to pay for meters. What's your take?
Well, first of all, we're not supposed to pay for meters. Nobody should, as long as you don't pay for the wires that make up the transmission network, or you don't pay for the generators, the turbines that they use for generators. Meters are what you call terminals, technically called terminals. So when you have an electricity supply system, the generation point is your turbine, your generator, whether it be a gas turbine, whether it is a water turbine, and it ends or terminates where you have the meter. It is basically a measuring device to determine the amount of electricity we have consumed. So that terminal should not be, because it's not, even if you pay for it, it is not your product. You can never own it. So typically what has happened with different policies set up by government, particularly the abolished CAPME, was that if, because of the metering gap, the existence and the inability of the distribution companies to bridge the metering gap within the acceptable period, if you decide to make a payment for that can be used to purchase the meter, the value of that meter can now be used as electricity service for you. So rather than maybe charging you for like 4 or 5 months period, whatever you pay for the meter is now used for you as a credit to your service. So that had been what has been existing. So then you will never find any DISCO that will give you an official receipt saying that you paid for a meter, because the whole thing cannot be right. So it's usually middlemen and all that, which if at the end of the day will boil down to something that is not legal. And even if the DISCOs are aware of it, they will feign ignorance because they can. Once you don't have an official receipt and the process isn't legal, people can deny.
Okay, but some people might want to disagree because I've had to help somebody purchase, you know, a meter. Because, I mean, you go to the bank, they even give you the MAP account number, you know, where you pay, and then, you know, you take it to their office. So it's an official process. So having to say that, and then the point where you said that it will be transmitted or transmuted into units to be used as electricity. Now, this was what happened. Even though after purchasing that meter, it was installed, they collected another sum of money for installation, which I later learned wasn't supposed to be the case. Now, having installed it, there was a certain amount of units in it, which is supposed to be what you're talking about now. But along the line, we were made to understand that after using that unit, when next you want to recharge, you would that unit is just meant to test the whether the meter is working or not. And so when you want to pay for the next, you will be made to pay for the unit used. Is that supposed to be the case?
Well, did they put this in writing? Or is there any evidence to...
But it was from their office.
Yes, but anybody can say anything. And whatever doesn't have evidence can always be denied. So what I'm just trying to allude to is basically what is legal and what is proper. Because if you make payment for something, under the law of contract, and there's a consideration, and you have made payment, that something becomes yours. So... If you have made payment for a meter and that amount has not been converted into electricity units, you can actually take them to court and own it, which would be a violation of the principles and the laws that actually make up the Electricity Act. So those are things that we need to verify. Am I saying that things always happen like this? No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that there could be unhealthy interference and sharp practices within the system, but it's also incumbent upon us to put pressure on the system to do the right thing. So when people make these explanations and they make these assertions, it is important to, as much as possible, get responses in writing. And the easiest ways to get responses in writing is to put complaints in writing. So I had the case of a neighbor who wanted to travel out of the country for a period of about 6 months. And at that time, he was even using a prepaid meter. Usually they will go and they will find out that the whole place, I mean, they keep billing them, sending bills even when nobody's around. So what he basically did was did a letter that he was traveling. And he got an acknowledgement. So when he came back and there was that bill, he took his letter with the acknowledgement to them and they reversed it. He didn't have to beg anybody and all that. But it would have been a different story entirely if he had no letter in writing, if he had met maybe a manager and the manager has given him his word, quote and unquote, that they would do it. It now becomes, well...
His word against...
Then it becomes... The man may not even deny. He may say, well, you know the policy, you know the way our people, you know, and all those things. But it's a different thing that he has a letter. Because with a letter, he can go to court and all that. So the point is, there's a lot of informality in the way we approach things, which has to do with our culture. It's really nobody's fault. But which people are also playing upon, you understand, to take unfair advantage of people. So... We should learn, because there's an arbitration process, we should learn to be putting things in writing, or should I say learn to be doing
things
in a way, yes, in a way that you will have evidence.
Okay, in the case of the person that has had to pay for meter, just like you said, it's supposed to be free, and even after finding out that there's free unit, she still had to pay for the installation as well as the unit that was in it. Now, you talked about lodging complaints. Who do you complain to? Is it the Nigeria Electricity Regulatory Commission? Who do you write to?
Okay, there are, yes, you can write to the NEC. You can also write to the Customer Affairs customer service department of the DISCO. Because normally, the idea is that before you take, escalate something to the regulator, you have engaged the DISCO.
DISCO, directly.
Directly. Once you don't have anything in writing, they can always say that you didn't come. So you don't want to appear like somebody who's just jumping on or just deliberately.
What about the tellers? Isn't it enough evidence?
That's not evidence that you are dissatisfied with the service. The evidence that you are dissatisfied with or have a
particular
complaint,
service.
Yes, is that you have made a complaint.
Now, talking about you having to pay for meter at the bank.
No, having to pay for meter at the bank is a policy process. So you pay a value that is worth the meter. But in tandem, that value that you pay is now translated to electricity units for you.
Okay, so then you can now lodge complaints if that does not happen.
So okay. Ultimately, what you did was pay for electricity units, the value of the meter. And that they used to get you a meter because of the shortfall in bridging the metering gap.
Gap, as should be.
Yes, so that's actually what should have happened. So where you don't have that happening, then there's something wrong.
Okay, so how would you assess Nigeria's long road to metering so far? We've started the journey and sometimes you see on the news, oh, meters have been distributed to this and this and people celebrate. But some, on the other hand, will say we haven't seen anything like that. And you see, so it's a two-way thing. So how would you assess, the journey so far?
I think, first of all, we need to understand that how did we even get here? When the privatization was to be done, the federal government asked those who were interested to do a privatization bid. And they did the bidding not on the basis of the person with the highest offer, but on the person with what you call the best business plan to solve the problems in the industry. And the submission of all the problems were summed up in what is called the ATC&C losses, which is aggregate, technical, collection, and commercial losses. ATC&C, aggregate, technical, collection, and commercial losses. So one of the losses areas is the collection losses. That's the ability to actually collect the services that have been dispensed. And meters was one of them. So in the business plans that the DISCOs themselves submitted, they had a plan to ensure that everybody is metered. But those plans obviously are not being met. So it is the responsibility of the regulators and those who have oversight to actually hold them responsible to the things that they have pledged. Now, there are many factors why they may not have met it. First of all, federal government has not done what federal government said they would do. There are issues with fluctuation of the naira, which nobody banked on because they borrowed money in dollars. They had to pay back their money in dollars and naira keeps falling and all that. So there are issues whether they should make special rates for them so that they can be getting dollars. So there are so many issues. But now it is the job of the regulator that will now say, okay, these are the circumstances that you find yourself. How can we help you so that your responsibilities are met? So it's like a parent who has a child who is underperforming. How do you help the child? I mean, you don't throw the child away simply because the child is underperforming. So how do you help these people so that they can meet their needs? Because if you don't do that and you just say, meet your needs, meet your expectations, you now have a situation where the people who should be doing what will make the industry improve will only be seeking out for themselves so that they can pay whatever money that they are owing and then move on. So basically, the issue of the bridging the meeting gap rests squarely on the DISCOs themselves, on the industry regulators, NEC, Ministry of Power, the
key
CBN.
Players in the
yes,
industry.
Those who have oversight responsibility, even the National Assembly. Because if they don't come at it from let's resolve the problem perspective, if they are holding just a finger pointing approach, they will not solve anything.
Okay, at this point, we'll just take a quick break, and when we return, the conversation will continue. Don't go away.
I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.
You're still watching Energy Matters, and my guest has been Olabode Shoumi. He's an energy analyst and expert, and we've been talking about issues relating to metering in Nigeria, particularly bridging the metering gap. And at a point, you said something very key, which had to do with the mass metering program and how there's still a huge gap, you know, yes, to be met. Okay, so how would you first of all say, because I mean, the issue of metering was introduced to solve the problem of estimated billing, which a whole lot of people were complaining about. So how would you say that the national mass metering program, even if it hasn't gone as far as it should, but how would you say it has impacted so far in addressing the issue of estimated billing?
Okay, thank you. I think that first of all, there are some things that should be noted about estimated billing, which is basically the laws around it. And because many times people don't know what the laws are and what their rights are, they get cheated and all that. The policy around estimated billing, it's basically a situation where you find somebody who benefits from electricity, or a consumer who ab initio was being billed and suddenly is not billed. Either a faulty meter or meter has been removed for whatever reason, it's no longer billed. So you can, rather than completely cutting the person off electricity, they can estimate the amount of power used based on but the basis for the estimation is the last three known bills of the person. It is not any other way. So in other words, you just need to get a record of the last three known bills, and based on that, your estimated bill should not go beyond that. Anything other than that is a basis for a complaint.
Okay, but you would agree that that hasn't necessarily been the case in this climb.
Yes, it hasn't been the case, but there are nobody complaining.
People are complaining, but the thing is this.
You see, complaints is not gossip. Is not
murmuring or grumbling.
No, a complaint that is legitimate in this case has to be in writing. You have to place a complaint to the DISCO. When there is no response from the DISCO, you can now escalate it to the regulator. If you are even dissatisfied with the regulator, you can sue them for damages, because the policy that exists states that estimated bills need to be around the last known bills of that particular customer. So that is a policy of government. If those people are violating it, they're also violating your rights. So on the basis of that, you can seek redress in court. Because not only will they be made to pay you back what you have paid that is in excess, they will also pay for damages for the inconveniences that have passed. And if that happens once or twice, rest assured the others will not continue. Because one of the things is that we actually don't fight for our rights.
Okay, so recently it was all over the news that there was a hike in the meter for those who are using, you know, especially those with a single phase meter, and a lot of chatters here and there and all that. But then also we also saw the company coming to clear the air and saying, no, this is not the case, it's not what you thought it was. So can you explain better, in expert but layman's understanding, what exactly all the dilly-dallying and here and there was about?
Well, there's an increment in the cost of a meter. I mean, they may call it price adjustment and all that. At the end of the day, there's an increment in the price. But to my understanding, the increments is as a result of the fluctuating price of the naira against the dollar. Because I think even for local manufacturers, close to 60% of the meter, the cost of producing the meter is imported, so it's forex denominated. So once there is a fluctuation in the price of the forex, it affects all those parameters. And on the basis of that, it is not so much that the value has increased. So let's say it's not like the dollar value of the import has increased, but because the dollar has risen against the naira, or the naira has fallen against the dollar, it affects every single thing that is import dependent and that is a factor, and for which you pay on naira. So that's really the issue.
Okay, so I've had a conversation with someone who is still maintaining, or you know, does not have a meter. And so the issue is, okay, I think I'm in, it's more like, it was more like an argument, a friendly argument, where the person was saying, even though I use the estimated system of billing, I pay lesser than you who uses the meter, even though you claim to pay as you use. But with all of this increases and all of that, you can almost not say that you're paying better than I am, or something like that. So how would you juxtapose, you know, has the meter actually solved the problem that it's supposed to solve, or it's doing more that as to complicating matters? Because you just rightly said now that, just like we're seeing the food inflation and many other things go high, one should expect that the purchase of electricity too will go high, especially if you use meters, and maybe even those who use the estimated. So how would you juxtapose? Has it really solved the problem that it has come to solve?
Well, let's look at it this way. Many people try to game the system. They try to change the system. It's also an issue, one of the main issues the people within the value chain will talk to you about. And we call those people, we call them smart or whatever, but nobody's really smart, because you're not really outsmarting the system, because nothing is really free. So what you take and don't pay, somebody else pays for it. That's just a fact of the matter. Now,
are you talking holistically?
Yes,
now?
Holistically.
Okay.
Somebody is paying for it. So those people, and when somebody cannot pay for it and the system cannot absorb it, the system will collapse. So those people who think they are actually gaming the system are actually contributing to the dysfunction of the system. So that's the first thing to first of all note. Now, it is not about who pays less or who pays more. It is more about people paying for what they use. We should be more interested with people paying for the value of what they use. Because if you pay for what you use, you have a sense of responsibility with your usage, so that you can now determine what you pay for. So you can determine to reduce your usage so that you pay less, or increase your usage based on whatever you need. You know, it puts a sense of responsibility on people. But if people don't have that sense of responsibility, where they feel that it doesn't matter what I use or don't use, they're still going to bill me anyway. Those are the things that are not ensuring that there's a proper responsibility matrix in terms of how people look at the usage. But really, truly and fundamentally, it doesn't matter whether you use estimated billing or not. There's a process for estimated billing. The DISCO doesn't want to be cheated and should not be cheated. The consumer doesn't want to be cheated
and
should not be cheated. So it is responsibility always upon us to do the right thing.
I think we should round off on that note. And I'd like to put it this way. The responsibility is upon us to take responsibility for the electricity that we use. My guest has been Olabode Showumi. He is an energy expert and analyst, and we've been discussing issues relating to metering in Nigeria, as well as bridging the gap of metering. Thank you very much for coming on the program.
Thank you. Pleasure is mine.
Actually, it's been a pleasure speaking with you. Let's take a quick break. The program continues shortly. Stay tuned. I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.
My name is Oyebode Fadipe. I am General Manager, Corporate Communications, Abuja Electricity Distribution PLC. My point of view in respect of the metering of customers in the power sector and by extension the Nigerian economy is that that is the way to go, because it does not make business sense that you keep customers on estimated billing. One is the fact that customers themselves are suspicious of estimated billing. They think from their own perspective that they are not getting accurately billed. Yet the discos themselves or players in the power sector hold the view that we are also not billing correctly. So metering, which is a neutral arbiter as a measuring device, helps to balance those opposing positions. There are two extreme positions that are clashing with themselves. So with a meter installed for the customer, you know that there is no room for controversy. The other thing that that meter will do is that discos will be able to account for their energy. Let's even leave the financial side of it. They will be able to say that, okay, we received 500 megawatts of energy and we are able to account for the 500 megawatts of energy plus or minus the allowable loss in the system, because electricity is heat, and as it is passing through the wires, as it is passing through the cables, you also lose a bit of them. The second reason why you also lose a bit of them is the age of the equipment that the electricity is passing through. So when you have a meter in a place, it helps you to account for the energy. The third point why metering is a fantastic way to go is because it allows for transparency between the customer and the discos themselves, so nobody is in doubt about what is happening. It's not an opaque relationship or opaque transaction, as it were. So metering is the way to go. Perhaps the fourth point which we have seen in Abuja Electricity Distribution PLC is that the loss level is higher in high estimated billing areas. In other words, in areas where you have low meter density but high population density, the loss level is usually very, very high. So metering of electricity customers is the way to go in the power sector as far as my own viewpoint is concerned.
I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.
If you paid attention to what my guest said, you would find out that you might have been doing the wrong thing by paying for those meters. And even if you have to pay for it, you should expect that you will get the unit cost value of the same. Ideally, meters should be free because they are the property of the discos. But Nigerians have put up with the option of phased payment, and there is need to guard against extortion of consumers by those implementing the program, as some say they see it as an opportunity for unjust enrichment. Now, some time ago, a bill seeking to criminalize estimated billing by the discos was presented before the House of Representatives, and it was seen as a step in the right direction, and the legislation aimed at alleviating the burden on electricity consumers, more especially in a country where the plight of the suffering masses is hardly taken into account by some quarters, as some say. Notwithstanding the opposition from the discos to the bill, the lawmakers were enjoined to do everything within their power to get the bill passed into law in the interest of equity, fairness, and justice. It is expected that the aim of the mass metering program to distribute meters to those who need them across the nation would be met in no time. But while that is hoped for, it is only okay for you as a consumer to know your rights and know that you should not pay for meters directly. You could pay, but then you know that you should get a unit cost of the same in return. Having learned that, it is only nice for us to wrap it up at this point on Energy Matters. We hope that you look out for the program same time next week. I'm Eunice Johnson. Bye.
I'm Eunice Johnson. Thank you for watching Energy Matters.